Welcome to Rap and Repression. And I'm going to first pick up the themes that I've heard echoed throughout the conference up to this point and wed all of our comments and remarks to those that have gone before us, because everything we've talked about hitherto is relevant to our rap and repression discussion, right? I think it's really apt, for example, that we have on our flyer juxtapose the heads of Edward Snowden and Chuck D, right? Both are fierce critics of state surveillance, one, which we'll get to in a little while, you know, louder than a bomb, the CIA, the FBI, okay, and state oppression generally. And we'll get into some other commonalities between the two. So we're gonna discuss rap and repression in the ways that the conference has over the last couple days on the basis of this distinction, that between state repression of freedom of expression and civil society's repression of freedom of expression, right? So that distinction kept coming up throughout the couple days to this point, and I even heard it this morning. So let me start with what I mean by state repression of freedom of expression. 2007, I guess it was, we had a program called Rap Race and Redemption over at Bovard Auditorium. And that's a lot better. I feel like a puppet with the strings cut. We did a program called Rap Race and Redemption over at Bovard Auditorium that was keynoted by Ice Cube, who did a live performance of a lot of his music. Especially controversial was his live performance at NSC's auditorium that we discussed after he performed it, Fuck the Police, coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad because I'm brown and not the other color, so police think. They got the authority to kill a minority. Right? That's political speech. What is that but oppositional political discourse? For uttering those words, he was told, and when I was interviewing him, he said, you know, it's not quite like the movie it portrays it, quite as dramatic as that, but he was told by the sheriff's deputies that if you utter those words, we're going to lock you up. He uttered those words and they locked him up for criticizing the police in a song. Right, so that's one example of state repression of speech. Another face we're going to have a chance to talk about when we get Eric Nielsen up here is when rap lyrics are used in criminal trials to obtain convictions against defendants who cut rap songs of some kind or posted rap songs of some kind. Right, those lyrics, for over 30 years now, and Layla Steinberg, I know when we were up in San Quentin, she was telling me that some of her former students have been incarcerated in part on the basis of their rap lyrics. Right? So your words can get you incarcerated, can trigger state repression in two different ways when it comes to rap music, both in the court system and through an outright arrest by the police officers themselves. That's one set of issues we want to deal with. The other is, what about civil society's response to rap? Right? Civil society, not state actors who say that rap should be censored, that it encourages bad behavior, that it is misogynistic and anti-LGBTQ. Right? What about those critiques from private citizens, private actors in civil society, right, about the music? We're going to have to grapple with that as well, of course. And I'm going to set the stage for the, you know, these two cases that I want to discuss of transgressive forms of symbolic communication, because that's what we've really been talking about, not just words. We've been talking about all kinds of both linguistic and non-linguistic forms of symbolic communication that can be offensive or in some way repressed. That can include flags like the Confederate flag. That can include things like, oh, follicle fashion, here. Right? I started writing my book, 4 years ago now. And when I write, I get into a hole in which I don't want no air, no food. Oh, let me see. Thank you. I get in a hole in which I don't want no air, no food, no water. That's my writing hole. You know, my kids used to, my wife will confirm, my kids would tease, oh, daddy's writing, we need cemetery silence. Cemetery silence, right? So in my cemetery silence frame of mind, the last thing I'm thinking about doing is going to the barbershop during my sabbatical. So I miss 8 months of going to the barbershop. I ain't thinking about that. My mind is on the book I'm writing. I go and start teaching criminal law. Now let's start with civil society. And I overhear my students saying, another student's report that students are saying that I'm teaching criminal law now, that it's ironic that Professor Armour teaches criminal law while he looks like a criminal. Right? I go downtown, address some downtown attorneys about some commercial transaction and tort issues. It's reported back to the law school by them that my appearance is impertinent and unprofessional. You know, it's at that point that I said, grow, baby, grow. Right? I wanted miracle grow, any kind of growing. Right? The bigger and nappier, the better. Because if you look at my pictures back when I was in high school, Kobe Bryant's high school, any LA fans? LA, Kobe Bryant, Laura Marion. I went to Laura Marion High School. I had the scoring title before him, 24 a game my senior year. He obliterated that. Please, 24 a game. When I was at Laura Marion, you know, grappling with the hardwood, I had a fro as big as this because it made me, instead of six, almost 5'6", 8". So, you know, and in our day, it was just a celebration of the African-American soul. That's how it was back in the day. Now, you know, it had become something more, and thanks to the institution of tenure's a beautiful thing. Tenure means never having to say you're sorry. Right? For telling the truth. For being transgressive. Right? So thanks to that institution, I let it grow. But, you know, I then, because of my non-linguistic symbolic communication, I said, look, right now I realize that there's more at stake in this than just follicle fashion, and so I'm going to push that point home. I started running into trouble with other areas of civil society on the basis of my non-linguistic expression, namely guards down at JW Marriott, three of whom approached me while I was in the lobby and said, they sent the black one over and the two white ones stood back. He says, sir, are you here to see someone? And I was there to see my old roommate from A Better Chance, Lino Garcia, who's now the general manager of ESPN Deportes. I said, yes, I am, but why aren't you asking anyone else in the lobby? And he said, we've been having a problem with transients. And I said, the obvious, oh, so you're saying I look like a transient? And how did I look? I had on a sports jacket, slacks, hard shoes. I did not have a tie. That's the only thing I didn't have, and a button-down shirt. He said, sir, don't take it personally. He walked away. I called. Nice thing about teaching for 20 years, you have students at places like Latham and Watkins. I called one former student. I said, if he comes back, I want you to hear this. He came back. He says, sir, what is the name of the person you've come here to see? Now, as a tort lawyer, I can tell you quickly how you that situation should be characterized. If I don't give him a name he can find in the database, I've assumed the ejectable status of a trespasser. And they were getting ready to lay hands on me and throw me out of the lobby for my non-linguistic, symbolic communication, right? My expression of love for who I am and solidarity with people who are going through my experience, right? So not only that, just real quickly, the state, and Frieda confirmed this, the state, I got a sheriff pulling his gun, a statue outside the house now, because when I grew this, again, non-linguistic form of symbolic communication, I was treated very differently than when I looked like Obama. Right, I come out my house, two sheriff's deputies draw guns on me, put me in the back of a car, say somebody reported a gunshot in the neighborhood. When I walked out of the house in my jeans and looking like this, I didn't look like I belonged in our View Park, upper middle class, black Beverly Hills neighborhood. So they put me in the back of that car, got the SWAT team, came through, and then, oops. Being big, black, and nappy, even in black neighborhoods, can get you in trouble. Trying to express your, you know, African-American soul can get you in trouble. So that's non-linguistic. Let's talk about linguistics forms of symbolic communication for a moment and framing this discussion for today, the N-word in particular. A lot of my work features the N-word, has featured the N-word for a long time, and by N-word I mean nigger, by the way, or nigger. When Chris Rock says, I love black people but I hate niggas, he's not distinguishing between and He's treating just like an right? Deciding to feature this word in my scholarship and other work was especially tricky, or at least ironic, in the USC context, because Marty Levine has told me that there was a guy who used the N-word in, at the end of one of his classes to make a kind of general point about language, a liberal prof at SC that we all know real well found that objectionable, went to the dean, and the dean asked for his resignation. Now, this is what Marty Levine tells me, right? So I am embracing this word that apparently has gotten somebody put down. Why do I use the N-word? We've been talking about comedy a lot over the course of, you know, cartoons and comedy over the course of the weekend. Well, here is a famous joke that a lot of us in the black community know. And by the way, when we talk about comedy and jokes, I'm assuming that, like James Boyd White says, a joke, is, like all text, is an invitation to become a certain kind of person, to respond to the world in a certain way. Any author of any text has that in mind, is trying to create a community with the reader. And so a joke invites you to become a certain kind of person. You accept that invitation when you laugh. That's why you feel so guilty when you laugh at a racist joke or some other joke that belittles others. When you laugh and then you feel guilty right away for the laughing because you know you've accepted an invitation to become a certain kind of person at that very moment. That's what jokes are. Right, and so when Chris Rock, in the famous comedy routine that launched his comedic career, said, walking back and forth in front of, on a stage in front of an auditorium full of black folk, it's like a civil war going on in black America, and there's two sides. There's black people and there's niggas. And niggas have got to go. I love black people, but I hate niggas. Boy, I wish they let me join the Ku Klux Klan. Shit, I do a drive-by from here to Brooklyn. Right, that's the routine that launched his career. His core definition of a nigger, by the way, was a black person who's done a crime. Black criminals. Right, so by that definition, the up to 90% of young black males in some of these neighborhoods right around here are going to wind up in jail, on probation, on parole at some point in their lives. And I did pinpoint cite that when the editor of my this most recent journal said that just sounds hyperbolic. Can we get a pinpoint cite on that? Yes, 90%. He's saying that up to 90% of young black males are niggas. Do you want to accept any distinction that relegates that staggering percentage of your community to niggerdom? That's why I use the word. I use the word to critique that mentality, right? To take on that politics of respectability-driven distinction between good Negroes and bad Negroes, right? But my use of that word has gotten me into a lot of trouble, right? MSNBC said, we can't put up your documentary. We can't put up the title of your documentary, Professor Armour, because it will traumatize our viewers to see nigger theory in a title. Publishers have been have been twisting my arm to get rid of that damn word. It's too traumatizing. It's too charged, you know, for commercial purposes, they keep telling me. And I'm not going to let it go. Let me just put it that way. Very, very simply, I'm not going to let it go. I decided I wasn't going to let it go when I got the spirit that I now see animating a lot of the activists at the forefront of Black Lives Matter. For me, from what I'm seeing of Black Lives Matter, I can't speak as a member, but I can speak as somebody who is wowed by what they've been able to achieve. Right? I see disruption and uncomfortable conversations as the hallmarks that I see jump. We're going to disrupt. We're going to cut through the complacency. We're going to cut through the smugness. We're going to cut through all of the indifference and apathy with disruption. And then we're going to have some uncomfortable conversations. Let's have some uncomfortable conversations. But first, we got to get your attention. Because you're somewhere else while we're dying in the streets and dying all everywhere else. So in that spirit, when I went to the American Association of Law Schools annual conference in New Orleans in 1999 to speak about social cognition and criminal law and to be very erudite, like we're supposed to be in those conferences when you have a room full of Tweedy law professors. Right. Just before going to that conference, I went to Terminal Island down here in San Pedro, federal prison. Right. And I couldn't go to that conference and go through the same old ossified language of the academy rigmarole. So instead, after setting it up, I gave them a little bit of I said the words of the prophets that you should say are written on the subway walls and tenement halls. Now they're coming out of these boom boxes in the form of these street prophets. And we haven't been listening to them at our peril. We could have anticipated the 92 riots if we had listened to something like Ice Cube's Nigga You Love to Hate, in which he says, I heard payback's a motherfucking nigga. That's why I'm tired of getting treated like a goddamn stepchild. Fuck a punk because I ain't him. You got to deal with the 9MM. The day is coming that y'all hate. Just think if niggas decide to retaliate. They try to keep me from running up. I never tell you to get down. It's all about coming up. So what they do, go and ban the AK. My shit wasn't registered any fucking way. So you better duck away, run, and hide out. When I'm rolling real slow with my lights out, because I'm about to fuck up the program, shooting out the window of a drop-top bro-ham. While I'm shooting, let's see who will drop. The police, the media, suckers at one pop. Motherfuckers that say they too black, put them overseas, they'll be begging to come back. They say keep them off gangs and drugs. You want to sweep a nigga like me up under the rug. kicking shit called street knowledge. Why more niggas in the pen than in college? Because of that line, I must be your cellmate. That's from the nigga you love to hate.
I heard payback's a motherfucking nigga. That's why I'm sick of getting treated like a goddamn stepchild. Fuck a punk, cause I ain't him. You gotta deal with the 9-double-M. The day's coming that you all hate. Just think, if niggas decide to retaliate and try to keep me from running up, I never tell you to get down. It's all about coming up. So what they do, going down to 8K? My shit wasn't registered any fucking way. So you better duck away, run and hide out. When I'm running real slow and the lights out, cause I'm about to fuck up the program. Shooting out the window of a drop top pro ham. Well, I'm shooting, let's see who drop. The police, the media, suckers that went pop. The motherfuckers that say they too black. Put them overseas, they be begging to come back. They say we promote gangs and drugs. You wanna sweep a nigga like me up under the rug. Kicking shit, call street knowledge. Why more niggas in the pen than in college? And cause of that line, I might be your cellmate. That's from the nigga you love to hate.
Let me go to now one of our honored guests. I love everybody who's going to be on the stage today. My God, you know. But when I was in law school, there was a voice that was in my cassette player back then, CD player. Actually, I think we moved up to CDs back then. CD player nonstop. It helped me get through. It was important to my mental health and. With my dad having been falsely incarcerated and having to appeal his own way out of prison, teach himself the law on the cell floor that he was, cell room floor he was in. When I heard for the first time Chuck D saying, I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it, said they were suckers. They wanted me for their army or whatever, picture me giving a damn. I said, never. Here's a land that never gave a damn about a brother like me and myself because I never did. I wasn't with it. But just that very minute, it occurred to me, the suckers got authority. Cold sweating as I dwell in my cell. Now, here's my old man. How long has it been? They got me sitting in a state pen. I got to get out, but that thought was thought before. I contemplated a plan on the cell floor. That's my dad, you know, with his typewriter punching away, appealing his way out of jail, which he did in Armour versus Salisbury. I teach in my criminal law class today, right? That's Chuck, that's how I first connected with Chuck D and Public Enemy, Black Steel in an Hour of Chaos, you know. And when you started talking about this politics of respectability, I heard that in the music when we went over to so-called gangster rap, because Chuck D was bringing just knowledge, right? But he wasn't saying, I'm coming from a criminal background. I was a drug dealer. I was a dope dealer. Pac, Nas, Big, Cube wasn't really one, but he identified with that narrative. Hove, you know, are saying that. We're coming from that perspective saying, those people you call N-words, I'm one of them, and I'm going to give you their perspective. I'm going to penetrate pop culture with the perspective of the so-called N-word. Right, and hopefully generate sympathetic identification with you through my music, which many of you are blasting in your, by the way, suburban bedrooms. As part of that, you could hear, listening to that music, a critique of the politics of respectability by somebody like Nas, right? Saying, let's hear two for the spooks who do cartwheels because they said they played their parts well. Now they claim caviar, I hate that oxtail, Lambda Sigma Phi badge on lapel. Why do you always tell him who he speaks so well? Are you the one we look to, the decent Negro, the acceptable Negro? Hell no, but they say these are our heroes.
This ain't for everybody. Y'all know who y'all are. Yeah, you know who you are. These are our heroes.
So now let's get everybody up here. I wanted to give you that general background to the introduction for some of you to rap. Some of you have been steeped in this music probably all your lives. Some are much less familiar with it. I wanted to give you at least some background frame for the discussion that's going to go on. I'm going to just very quickly introduce folks because I want us to get into discussion. Because, you know, the list of honors and accolades for each of these names is long. I'm not going to go into all of them, but I'm going to start with Eric Nielsen. Could you come on up, Eric? He's a young prof now at liberal arts at the University of Richmond, researching where his research and teaching focus on hip hop culture and African American literature. He's the co-author of The Hip Hop and Obama Reader by Oxford University Press. He's got a great amicus brief before the Supreme Court now on the use of rap lyrics in criminal trials, criminal proceedings, or other formal legal proceedings that involve some kind of sanction. And so we'll get into that a lot more shortly. Melina Abdullah, AKA Doc Melly Mel on Twitter, chair of the Pan-African Studies at California State University, Los Angeles, earned her PhD from SC. Okay, so we got a family member in the house working on a book about hip hop and political mobilization. She serves, I could go on and on, but I know Melina especially through the Black Lives Matter work that she's been involved in, just tremendous stuff that she's doing, helping to promote this sea change in American attitudes about race that's occurred over the last 18 months to 24 months that you can see in the Pew Research polls and in the CNN polls. And Black Lives Matter's had an enormous, you have upwards of 20, 25, 30% more percent of Americans saying that race is either a serious problem or the country's number one problem over the number that were, or percentage that were saying that 24 months ago. That's a movement that's having an amazing impact, right? And I've seen what that impact can be. When I started teaching 97 here, same-sex intimacy was a felony in a lot of states. It wasn't until 2003, Lawrence, Texas, that it wasn't a felony anymore. Now we take for granted that they should have marital rights, right? That's what changing hearts and minds can do, and that's what Black Lives Matter has been able to achieve. Layla Steinberg and I go so far back. Man, she was she's a manager, businesswoman, educator, writer, poet, dancer, singer, and founder of Assemblies in Motion, mentor, of course, and first manager for Tupac Shakur. We just got the list goes on and on, but it's great to have you here. And obviously not least, but last, Carlton Douglas Ridenour, right now I just know him as Mr. Chuck D. Mr. Chuck D. That's all I know him as, you know. And I'll just say this about this brother as he's coming up here and his artistic accomplishments. There are, in my mind, thank you for being here. There are, to my mind, four albums before 90 that were just game changers. You know, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Heart Club Band, What's Going On, Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, Songs in the Key of Life by Stevie Wonder, what songs, and then finally, It Takes a Nation of Millions. It Takes a Nation of Millions. I mean, just landscape changing, back to back, no I Want to Hold Your Hand song, no nothing but cold, hard, political rap. From bottom to the top, right? And making it sell, making it popular, you know, changing the culture with it. It's just awesome to have Chuck D up here. And I'm going to let Melina introduce Lene Davis, because without her, you can't do any of this without a serious DJ.
So we also want to pay respect to not only one of the most phenomenal DJs in the world, but also a scholar, Africana Studies, Pan-African Studies scholar and professor at Cal State LA, Lene Denise, who if you don't know, now you know.
All right, I want to jump right in, into a lot of this. I'm going to start with you, Eric, even though, you know, when you get a God MC like Chuck D, you just all the energy wants to go toward, you know, the person who influenced my mental development at a, you know, all from 22 on, when I first started really listening seriously to PE. But I want to start with this use of lyrics like yours, Chuck D, like your song, I don't think we actually played this. I am a rock hard trooper to the bone, the bone, the bone, full grown, consider me stone once again, and I say for you to know, the trooper's always ready, I yell Geronimo, your CIA, you see, I ain't kidding. Both King and X, they got rid of both. A story unknown, true but untold, Professor Griff knows, and then Professor Griff, in defending the Palestinians, gets into trouble, right? So that's a whole nother layer of trouble that we've talked about this weekend, right? But that whole kind of the state coming after you for what you're saying, surveilling you, you know, tapping your telephone, you know, tapping the funk, you know, the lyrics, everything. What are they doing with the courts, Erica Nielsen, in using rappers' lyrics against them to secure criminal convictions? And how's all that going?
Well, it's going very well for the state. It's happening all the time. You know, I figured one way to sort of introduce this would be to give you an example, and it was an example that helped me, along with lots of other scholars that I'm working with, to sort of make this more public. And I'll give you this example. This is in New Jersey. A man named Vontae Skinner was charged with attempted murder in 2005 for the shooting of a man named Lamont Peterson. Police had very little evidence, no real physical evidence connecting him to the crime, but the prosecutor wanted a conviction. The problem was that along with a lack of physical evidence, there was conflicting eyewitness testimony. The victim first said Skinner was the shooter, then said he definitely wasn't the shooter, then said he was the shooter. So really there's not much of a case here. So to reinforce it, to bolster it, what prosecutors did was they introduced 13 pages of his violent rap lyrics, even though they had all been written months to years before the crime, made no mention of the victim, and had no details that connected to the crime in any way. And they read, the prosecutor read these 13 pages uninterrupted in front of a jury. Big shock, they found him guilty and put him up for 30 years. Now, ultimately, he appealed to the New Jersey Superior Court, which overturned his conviction, saying they doubted very much any jury would have found him guilty had they not been listening to those highly prejudicial lyrics. Ultimately went to the Supreme Court, and in a relatively rare victory, the Supreme Court overturned his conviction, noting that the use of rap lyrics in that case was inappropriate and would have prejudiced the jury. The problem is that we know that there are hundreds, and I'm certain it's thousands if you consider all aspects of the criminal justice system, sentencing hearings, indictments, but we know there are hundreds of cases where rap lyrics are introduced in a similar fashion to secure convictions. I've probably worked on close to 30 of them. I've served as an expert, or am serving as an expert in 7, maybe 8 now. All 3 I'm working on now are capital cases. So these are people whose rap lyrics could literally have them killed. It is pervasive and widespread. And so that is one of the things that I have devoted the last couple of years to. And I don't want to say it's just me. I've had a lot of help along the way, including a criminologist, Charis Kubrin at UC Irvine. And increasingly from members of the industry themselves, particularly Killer Mike, who over the last couple of years has been working with me a lot, and I appreciate his advocacy, but that's why I'm so happy to be here, because this is unjust at a lot of levels. And I think maybe as we go into it, we can talk about why this is happening, why we're having trouble stopping it, but the point is, it's widespread, it's pervasive. The overwhelming majority of defendants are young men of color, usually amateur rappers, right, who don't have the name recognition as artists, or frankly, the bank accounts to mount a robust defense. And so they become easy prey for prosecutors who essentially play to enduring stereotypes about young black and brown men in order to send them away, sometimes for life, and in some cases, as I mentioned, even worse than that.
Mr. Chuck D., did you have any contacts yourself with any law enforcement agencies, or were did you hear that you were being under surveillance and it was a serious issue?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say greetings to everybody and thank you for having me on the panel, and especially in this great panel right here. So I've transcended into being a great listener more than a talker, but then I've been asked to speak. And sometimes I might sound like I'm coming from another planet, because in this United States of America, when we start thinking that we're Earthersons, that's quite alien to these governments. So yeah, I speak from knowing that I wasn't a kid when I was writing these songs in 1986 and 1987. And I come from the 60s where the community really saw they were obligated to teach you what schools weren't going to teach you. Community really kind of like, old heads really kind of told you the deal in 68, 71, 74. You know, they told you the deal. So in writing these songs, fast forward to 12, 13 years later in 86, 87, in the middle of R&B, and that was Reagan and Bush. But I was giving it to you as it was. I mean, Louder Than a Bomb, which was those lyrics that came from that song. Louder Than a Bomb spoke to, at that particular time, my phone would cut off between 11 and 1 o'clock every night. It was just like, it'd go dead. So after calling the phone company, and they say they don't know what's up, and it'd be popping on at 1. And then you start to say, well, call it, what's up with my phone? Then I took it upon myself as a songwriter to kind of put 2 and 2 together and make 5. So that's where that came from. Plus being equipped with knowledge ever since I was a shorty running around, I knew what COINTELPRO was. And when you start reading about history and what happened back then, it's naive to think that any kind of counterintelligence is going to be frozen in the same tactical way that it was. So you have to think new ways.
Keep and going, so, Chuck. I want you to definitely keep that thought for some of the youngins who may not be up on COINTELPRO. It's a
counterintelligence program. It's like, if you have your... Streetwise, if you got some sense about yourself and trying to unite people in the same court of thought to get things moving, you got somebody that want to count or something that wants to counter that intelligence. And the counterintelligence program it stopped movements coming off of J. Edgar Hoover in the 60s and the 50s. Y'all could Google your phones for this stuff. But a long story short, knew at that particular time that rap music and expression as an expression in our music and our culture, just cutting it down to a real short paragraph, the expression of a people who refused to be listened to and also refused to be able to express ourselves and talk. Our music, whether it be in the churches, whether it be in the streets, our music was our expression to let you know what was going on with our soul.
Chuck, you called it the Black CNN. I quote you all the time.
Well, at that particular time, CNN was CNN or whatever it was, but we as Black folks didn't have any kind of reflection, so our music was our reflection. Our culture was our reflection. It might have popped through Ebony and Jet once in a while if everybody had it on their piece, but the music was a simple thing to let everybody know that this is how people were living in Watts, to tell somebody in Raleigh, North Carolina what was going on. There was no other thing other than maybe reading those magazines or that would actually tell you. So the music would actually convey those relationships that, wow, there are Black people in LA. When I was growing up in New York, we knew there was Black people in LA because of Soul Train. And I was like, I want to get the Soul Train. If you didn't listen, and back then especially, if you didn't have people who lived in another city or state, you didn't know what was going on, relative to what you were about, who you were in those areas. If you had no cousins in California, California might as well have been, Thailand, or what you saw on TV. So when rap music and hip hop came out, the volume of words made it really descriptive to hear what was going on with Ice-T telling us about, oh wow, and when I finally met Ice-T, we already were kin spirits, because he was telling me what was going on. I was saying what was going on from Long Island. People might hear about New York, but you don't know nothing about Long Island until we was able to come up with the volume of words. So not to, to hog the panel with the discussion, but you know, long story short, when you keep people from expressing themselves, it's gonna come out. And the lure that we knew that was gonna happen with the music, because we are expressive people, because of the circumstances, we knew that the business was gonna be an expose. We knew the portal that was gonna express ourselves from within is also gonna be the portal that's gonna be vacuumed and drawn from. We're gonna get future generations to rely on this being their only communication, and they're gonna spill the goods. We're gonna turn rap into rat, and most of the time they're gonna just rat their insides out, because this is what we're gonna have set up as being their only expression or their main expression to each other. And eventually, the expression to each other will be on blast. It will be on Petri dish. It will be on that, what's that little rat that runs around in the maze? Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're gonna all watch this all play out, and we're gonna weave it with law, and we're gonna weave it with big business, and we're gonna get a volunteer environment to Big Brother instead of having Big Brother spy on them. Mm. So yeah, it's the same kind of push and pull that we had with rap music in the 90s, knowing how it was gonna be used, that Curtis Mayfield had struggling with Superfly. Curtis Mayfield comes out of the 60s with, you know, Amen, and also speaking really highly from a street spiritual point of view. But when he did Superfly, it dealt with the streets, but it being in Hollywood as a motion picture, they kind of like lopsided the side of Superfly to make it seem like this is a movie about cocaine. And it's about the cocaine, the game, and forget about the end results. We're gonna really entice you with the game and the activity and the lore and the. And Curtis was, he told me personally, he said, you know, he was bothered by that lopsided treatment of what he wanted to call a total rounded picture on his music delivery and depiction of what went down. So those same inner struggles were with people like myself knowing what was to come. I mean, I wasn't no kid in 1980. I was 27, 28 years old. I knew that dropping "It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back" was a double entendre. It was twofold. Takes a nation of millions to hold us back, meaning that we're a nation of millions within a nation. We'll hold our damn selves back if we don't pay attention. Right. And there's also a nation of millions of the opposition that will hold our ass back if we don't pay attention to collecting ourselves as a movement. But I got more to say when you ask me questions.
Yeah, right on.
At least I know to talk about what I've done, my damn self, and what you know, what I've written and what I meant when I wrote it, and how I can probably look in retrospect and tell you how that is differed, what it means now. Words stand the test of time, no matter what. You can always, you know, change what you think it meant or whatever, put some out of perspective to it, but the words don't move. And this is why they're powerful, especially if people are limited to one language.
I love that, the words don't move. We're gonna come back. Melina, that goes right to you. Surveillance, they're surveilling rappers like Chuck D, who are critical of the government. Here you are, scholar activist in the middle of Black Lives Matter, and there's surveillance going on of Black Lives Matter. And can you talk to us a little bit about that and how they're trying to take the legs out from under the movement, perhaps, possibly, if they start misusing all of this data that they're collecting on you?
Sure. So I also want to say thank you for gathering us. I'm really honored to be here to share space with everyone who's on the panel. It means a lot. So thank you for pulling us together. When Chuck was talking about the New York LA thing, I just want to lift up something that most of the students here won't remember, but I started laughing because remember when it took a while for a song to get from New York to LA, like y'all would have it. And then it would take us like 3-4 weeks, sometimes a couple of months to get here. Y'all don't know about that, right?
Soul Train made it. Soul Train made it everything national though. Don Cornelius made everything.
Right, but when we would travel, there was different music, so you don't get to enjoy that, right? Like going to different places and hearing different music that hasn't yet made it to your locale yet. In terms of surveillance, I think that when I think about hip hop, it's really important to think about what surveilled and what was under attack and why. And so kind of some of these oppressive lyrics, some of the things that we think about as misogynistic, as heterosexist, those are not the lyrics that are targeted, right? And those are not the artists that are targeted. The artists that are targeted are artists like Public Enemy, artists like NWA, right? If you think about the political power of F the Police, which is still like an anthem, right? In fact, MC Ren said to me that he didn't see any difference between saying F the Police and Fight the Power. That's just how they said Fight the Power, right? And so I think it's important that we think about that, that there's always a political motivation. The motivation is not about, you know, kind of trying to cure ails in society. It's about repressing people who would rise up against the existing hegemony, right? So one of the things that we can think about when we think about Black Lives Matter, without getting too specific, because my case is open, I think, until till December 23rd of this year. So I want to make sure I don't say anything that's surveilled, right?
Right, right, right.
And so I think it's really important that we think about what's happening. What's happening now in terms of surveillance and government repression is really targeting people who have the audacity to stand up against the existing hegemony, right? So when we think about, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement and kind of what was sparked 2.5 years ago when many of us decided after George Zimmerman was acquitted for killing Trayvon Martin that we ain't never going in the house, right? We decided that this is not gonna be a moment of uprising, this is gonna be a way in which we shift our lives. So my children are Black Lives Matter children, we call them our BLM babies. They are raised in the movement, right? The way that I live my life has shifted, and so all of us have basically decided that we are, we close our meetings with a chant called Asada, and the first line is, it is our duty to fight for freedom, and the second line is, it is our duty to win. And so what that means is that we are gonna keep struggling because as Black people, we can't be duped into thinking that we're incorporated into a system that was really built to oppress us, right? That until, you know, our folks are free, all of our folks are free, none of us are free. And so what we've decided is to unapologetically say that Black lives matter, Black women's lives matter, Black queer lives matter, Black children's lives matter, all Black lives matter. And what's interesting, that shouldn't really be a controversial statement, right? Because if this country were what it proclaims to be, that should be an of course, right? Instead, we get retorts. When we say Black Lives Matter, the opposing side says what?
All lives matter.
Right. Well, if all lives matter, what's wrong with saying Black Lives Matter, right? It doesn't even make sense because they mean really all lives except Black lives, right? And so the repression is around a language that says, you know, there are groups of us, there is a group of us that is at the bottom of every possible measure. We are the most incarcerated, we are the most surveilled and repressed. We are at the bottom of every health measure. We are the most under-resourced. We have the least amount of wealth. Our children are suspended at rates that are, you know, exponentially higher than every other group. And I could go on, but then that would take up this whole time, right? And so what we're seeing is, again, kind of this lifting up of government oppression. It was raised, COINTELPRO was raised. I'll say that what we're facing now, because COINTELPRO was not an above ground program, right? It took years to discover that COINTELPRO even existed. I think, when did it come out? 1975, that COINTELPRO?
Church Committee.
Uh-huh. And so now we're living under an era of the Patriot Act. That allows not only government surveillance, federal government surveillance, but when we think about, you know, I'm gonna just say it because my kids already said it, the cop at the back of the room, right? that he has the right to do certain things. He has the right to say, you know, there's something suspicious. And I could talk about, I don't want to sound like Hamid, but suspicious activity reports. You know, all of us are kind of being not only surveilled, but also our words are being used against us and warehoused in these massive files. And we need to think about what that means. So how do we, this is the last point, how do we then rise up or respond to that? What they're hoping we'll do is be quiet, right? So the point of this is not only to track us, but also to silence us. So one of the ways in which we can fight it is to create so much language, so much energy, so much action around these unjust kind of practices and policies that there's no way that they can kind of repress all of us. So when we say it is our duty to fight for freedom, I don't mean mine. I don't mean Pete White, who's also a member of Black Lives Matter. I don't mean my children. I mean all of us. It is our duty to fight for freedom, and it is our duty to win. And so we can't be afraid of the repression that we face, and when we stand together, we win. Yes.
Layla, I want to take a turn toward civil society's response to rap for a moment, away from the state for a moment, and what some people in the conference called vigilante repression. You know, when it's not state repression, you know, but oppression by these private citizens of free speech is one way to characterize it, a negative way. A more positive way is we're trying to bring some attention to misogyny and homophobia and other kinds of attacks on socially marginalized groups that should not necessarily be part of these art forms, and they perpetuate certain negative things. So there's a couple ways you could look at that, right, that same issue. But I know you've talked eloquently in our seminar, and when we went up to San Quentin and sat down with lifers all day with 22 seminar students from USC who had all kinds of respect for you because you've been going in the San Quentin for 25 years, took Tupac into San Quentin with you. You've talked eloquently about some of the concerns you have about some of the messages even Tupac was sending out, you know, with his genius, and he is, you know, and my Mount Rushmore rap, I'm just gonna put it on the table, you know, is Chuck D, Pac, Nas, Cube, and maybe throw in Hove, you know, for, that's right now my Mount Rushmore. Everyone has their own, you know, but that's just it. And so Pac has got to be on anybody's Mount Rushmore, and how you know, some list could leave him off like one recently did. I don't even know. Don't get me started. Layla, you know, what about this impact on these, you know, on these vulnerable groups, and you're thinking about how you may have, you know, in some way contributed to that?
Hi. Oh, that was a lot. What can't be said, right? So, gosh, I have so much to say and at the same time, nothing.
Take your time.
I started out, I'm the daughter of a criminal defense attorney. And all of my dad's clients when I was a child were not white. And that's because he worked as a public defender, and white kids at the time got private attorneys. So from the time I can remember, I thought there must be something wrong with the system. And my dad was fighting for the people. And I grew and watched, and very early on understood my privilege. My mom is a Mexican immigrant. No one knew that. And it's kind of surreal right now that I'm here, because I've been asked for weeks now to come to Atlanta where they're filming the Tupac movie. I can't have this conversation without talking about race, because it always is about race. So I opted to be here with all of you, and I'm here for my children. And it's always said that I'm a manager. I'm really not a manager. I do manage, and I work with artists, but management is not a business to me. It's really that I understand what it is to do business in an industry that's racist, so I fight for certain people that I love. But I have to backtrack a little to go forward. So they cast somebody to play me in the movie. She's British, blue eyes. It's pretty interesting. And it really represents exactly why I'm in this business and still fighting for people. I'm not British. I asked if she was going to wear contact lenses. I'm not dissing her. She's probably a great actress, and maybe I will meet her this week. And I hope she does a good job, but I wasn't there to help write. I wasn't participating in the makeup of this film, but just by the nature of the process and the casting, I'm always made to look like I was saving or helping someone. Mm. And it's not true. And I never wanted to manage Tupac or Mac Maul or any of the artists that I ended up working with, but the truth is we are so racist that they always needed someone that looked like me to get in the doors. And it all started in, I guess, 1979, when my ex-husband wanted to throw his first party and they wouldn't rent the facility in Venice to him. So I walked in and was like, hi, I'm Layla Steinberg. I want to throw an event. And suddenly the facility was not booked. And that's really how it started. And so what I found to be true was that this art form that I was involved in was the first time we could have an honest conversation, and that young white people that didn't understand the legacy or history of this country could participate in becoming accountable for a history of pain, a history of dysfunction, and a history of lies. So that's really why I entered the art form. I used to dance and sing in salsa and Nigerian bands. I didn't even want to be involved in rap in the beginning, back to language, because the speakers always had a bitch is a bitch coming out, or I could quote a number of Too Short and Eazy-E songs, and I had daughters, some of which are in the room right now. So I had a difficult time with a father who raised me and a mother, beautiful woman, but she was more active outside of the house. Incredible activist, worked with Cesar Chavez, did a lot of amazing work, not an active parent at home, and I needed that. And so just witnessing and understanding that we had to have deeper conversation, I suddenly was seduced by an art form that I felt I had to be part of. But I didn't like the language as a young mother in the early 80s. And so I kept saying, I want to work with somebody who speaks to the activism that I want to see. And that was my connection to Tupac. I met Pac, and it was like he had it. And so that was the beginning of my journey. I forgot what I was going to say because I had a whole point I was coming to.
But you know, his how he came to think about women, girls, like your daughters, and how you made peace with the, you know, with his work and rap more generally, of course.
I mean, I make peace with that everyone has to find their own accountability. And it's a process. It's funny, I had to bring this up because Mac Maul is an artist that I work very closely with, who probably 2 years into our working together, he got a letter from a young woman in Canada who said she had a really lucrative offer for him. And she wanted to come to the Bay Area and dance and work. He was 17 at the time. And before I knew it, Mac Maul was pimping. And this is his book, and it's an interesting story. I'm all through the book. I didn't want to be mentioned in it. And it's an important book because it talks about how he was seduced by women. And how we fought and fell apart in our working together, and I justified so much for the greater good of an art form that I thought and still believe could change the scope of our relationships globally. And I have evidence that it has, and it's only the beginning. But it hasn't been easy. I still fight, even with my own children, about the use of language and my lack of understanding, about the appropriation of language, about how I'm not comfortable using certain words, but I want my kids to have the freedom to use those words. But the reason I'm here is, where we work it out is in rooms like this. We have a lot of young rappers in the room, some of which are my students, some that I don't even know that actually saw the flyer and decided to show up. So at some point, I'd love to open the discussion up. But in the schools and in the colleges is where we have the conversations that go out. It's where we encourage our young writers to go deeper and to make shifts. And so I don't think there's been a more important art form to date than hip hop. I think there hasn't been a conversation that has allowed us all to process the pain and the history, and that's what we're doing. And I'm just here to participate in the discussion, not as an expert.
Great. Well, you came up with the great idea, and that is, let's turn it over to the audience. You know, I've hogged it long enough, and I'm gonna. Layla, start with one or two of your students. If you could point them out, we're gonna put them on the spot. We're gonna put them on the spot. Do you see any of them?
Well, we were talking actually about. Hi, Shane. I wasn't even gonna point at you, but I might as well because you're white and you rap. And I've been really, really hard on, more than anybody, my students that are white, that rap, because I used to write raps with Pac, but I never felt like I should be out there rapping. Every art form from the black community was taken, and it was the first time there was an art form that came from a community that had ownership in the community that created it. And Tupac used to yell at me all the time. He'd want to write with me, but he'd say, I better never hear you on a tape trying to rap. And so I never did, and I respected that. But that doesn't mean I don't think it's important. And do you have something a cappella that deals with maybe who you are, white, Orange County, and your experience? Should we put you on the spot?
Yeah, we're going to put him on the spot. Yeah, stand and deliver.
Since I've picked
bro.
On
stand
you so much.
Stand and deliver.
Should I hear what? How you doing, everybody?
You got to sign a release form. I have one in my bag.
All right. Once again, my name is Shane. Thanks, Layla. let's see if I got something I could do right now on the spot. Okay, just a little something. All right, now where I grew up, there's only one gang that ran shit. Rolling Thick, covering all over the planet. Massive evil, jacking people, and it's so sad. Harassing me for kicking it in front of my own pad. Like I'm living in the craziest dream. I mean, damn, shit was like a daily routine. Whatever you got in your pockets, I'm taking it. They said this is our hood, so you don't really have a say in it. They all strap with gats when they attack cats. And if you're talking back, then get your ass smacked. And they got way too many homies to fuck with. So I got wise and learned that I better run if I want to keep living. Even if my chucks got half the traction, I'm not the one you're gonna see slipping. Cause I'm a fast mother running past others on the track. Let the plot unfold, the story goes. The biggest gang in the nation today. From the slums of the Bronx all the way to LA. Them cats that be rolling deep. They're on the creep, beat your ass if you make a peep. The story goes. Time for some action. I can't believe nothing happened when they killed the homie Bassam. And now I ask, will it ever stop? You see the flash with the blast from another Glock. The story goes, running down the street with my heart pounding. Look around and all of a sudden I'll be surrounded. I need a plan, but I got nowhere to run to. And they don't like it man to man, they just jump you. Stuck in the same stable. I must be Cain, cause I ain't able to make a change in today's fable. And the funny thing is, now listen closely, my skin is white as hell and I'm from OC. So picture this, think about it real good. Shit is like 100 times worse in the hood. I ain't talking about the blood of cuz. I'm talking about the Buster Thugs. They used to call them the Fuzz. The biggest gang in the nation today. From the slums of the Bronx all the way to LA. Them cats that be coming around, running the town, trying to bring everybody down. The story goes. Driving the black and white. They ain't throwing up a set, they just have a light. Keep it flashing, dashing, but they got your ass in the spotlight. And they're quick to blast at anything that's not white. Open ear to the sound of the fact. Gotta notice what they're doing to the brown and the black. Now I'm mad because it just hurts. My story may be bad, but there's much worse. So listen up to the sound of the truth. All around is the proof of a gang that remains looking down at the youth. Ain't nobody down to make a change. Feeble brains see the problem but refuse to feel the pain. Slavery wasn't abolished, it was polished. Made nice and pretty, so now law is lawless. Like Lucy, I need me a warrior princess so we can rise up against this. The story goes. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for letting me put you on the spot like that.
That, you know, wow, on the spot. That's pretty good for on the spot. You know, off the spot, you know. Great, and maybe we'll mix something else in. I'm going to take a question now first, and then we're going to get to some possible more. Huh?
My name is Davey. I'm here for my son to apply to USC. We come from the Bronx, New York, even though we live in Maryland now. Hi, Chuck. I came because I saw the flyer. Mm-hmm. But it's more of a comment more so than a question when you brought up the N-word. I sort of cringe when I hear the N-word used for niggers or niggas, because the true definition, the true way to spell it is N-E-G-U-S, negus. And it's a Nigerian word. And when I hear the word, I think of sovereignty or king, or from royal background. I think we need to reclaim it and educate others about the true meaning of it. That's it.
You know, the reason I leap to agree with you is because I don't think any words are, we as lawyers, one thing we teach our law students is no words have fixed and frozen meanings. Meaning is mutable. You don't get anything else out of the first year curriculum. You get that, right? You take a word like intent, by the time lawyers are done with that word, it doesn't look anything like ordinary people mean when they use the word intent, or, you know, any number of other, you know, tools in our legal lexicon, right, or that way. So, yeah, no words have fixed meanings, but we can, in struggling over their meanings, we define ourselves, like struggling over the Confederate flag. When we struggle, when we say, even though the Confederate flag is very much like the N-word, both are forms of symbolic communication steeped in slavery and black oppression. Right. But we have taken the N-word, transvalued it, inverted it, and made it something positive in some settings. Sometimes we use it negatively, like Chris Rock did, I hate niggas, but sometimes positively. We haven't done that with the Confederate flag. We haven't gone the same route. We could. There's nothing inherent. We just decided not to. We haven't defined ourselves in relation to that symbol in the way we have other symbols. So I leap to agree with you on that. Yes.
Jody, can I just respond
to
that?
Yes.
So I think it's important that we, I think you're lifting up something that's important. Let me say that my children will never, ever say that word. I will never say that word. I was taught... I used to, I'm from Oakland, the N-word is like water there, right? Like, you know, it rolls off of your lips, right? And then when I hit ninth grade, I went to a school called Berkeley High School, which was the only school in the country with a black studies department. Like, so we had a whole department. Everybody was re-schooled when we got there. You better not say that word. And it's because the way in which it's been used in this country and on our people is an assault on our people. So the Latin root of the word actually is talks about us as being soulless beings, right? It's what Orlando Patterson talks about as a part of the social death of black people as enslaved folks, right? So I think, I know Pac talked, what was it, never ignorant, getting goals accomplished. That's not how he used it in the songs. That's not how most rappers use it. That's not what's meant when people use that word. So when I'm just gonna give a quick exercise, a challenge to folks. So when I got to Berkeley High, everybody got reschooled. Mr. Navies, God rest his soul, who I hope speaks through me right now, schooled us. And then he challenged all of us to school every other student that came into that high school, right? And so in that high school, the moment you set foot on campus, you stopped saying the word and we replaced it with brother and sister. And when you say that, it changes the energy. Donald Bakir writes on this. He has a book called The N-Word, The Black Curse, right? And the idea that when you say that word, not only are you cursing yourself, but you are cursing, I mean, not only are you cursing another person, but you're cursing yourself. So energetically, the release of that word is problematic. And I don't want to, like, dwell on it, but I think it's important that we really interrogate that, we really interrogate the truth of it. I absolutely agree we can't divide ourselves into good Negroes and bad Negroes or black people and ends, right? We're all African people. At the same time, let's not affirm the oppression that they've used against us by pretending like we have turned it into something positive, because that's absolutely not the case.
Chuck, I see you shaking your head, Chuck.
Yeah, I like to add that, you know, just in very real talk, context is everything. Context is very important. And I would like to say old heads matter. And old heads matter, just like young people matter, but the key is that the ground rules of society and the hood cannot be separated with these concocted gaps. And the gaps in age and status and ageism has affected to individualize a lot of young heads into thinking that they could create rules out of the space of their own heads. As we go on in time, I don't care anybody, whatever you choose or whatever, but one thing we know is definite. Time is definite. It belongs to no one. It will move forward. And as we move forward, old heads will be tested as the new gens begin to come in. And this is, and these gaps are conveniently placed by societies that want to have control over time and space, and they do. So the friction of having someone from back in the day, whatever back in the day, you want to figure out where that point starts, but saying that Black Lives Matter is not the way it should be this way, and you know, you want to encourage movements, you want to encourage organizations, you want to encourage collectives, because once anything is individualized, then it's set up and new generations come in and they have to be somewhat coached, but old heads cannot be in fear. And that's probably been the biggest thing I've seen over the last 30 years. Old heads in fear of younger people, their kids, new generations, technologies, new ways. You know, I mean, I got a statement, old tricks and new ways will always trick and amaze new gens in new days, right? Old tricks, they pull old tricks, but they disguise them differently.
Right.
Now you add technology into that mix,
right?
Where somebody say, I'm not into computers. Remember that was a statement 20 years ago? Oh, dog, I ain't into computers. Now that same head is on Facebook trying to look up girls in their old high school classes. So these, you know, these systems are always in motion. Fighting is like almost like, you know, your lungs got to fight to breathe in many cases. So you have to keep up a fight against something that's working 24 hours a day. But it got to be conveyed to younger generations. And not always, you know, the pressure shouldn't always be on academics. Academics tell people who have to damn near look at their children or look at young people every day and not be afraid to talk. But if you don't even, if you don't have the language, and you don't have a sense of yourself or who you are, and you haven't even kind of lessened the animosities inside yourself. 18 years ago like that, and a young person go from 0 to 18, really from 0 to 14, they grown. They grown at 13. And you at 31 or 43 or 55, tell them that, but afraid to get into the crux of it because you got your own struggles to try to understand as you're being individualized. One thing young people, you could say young people, I'm saying 18 and under, one thing we know is a definite. In this United States of America, right, if you're under 18 years old, chances are you're corralled and trust into a collective. Your little ass miles will go to school. So they already right. in packs of 20s and 30s and 40s, 50 people, and they walk out and they leave school. It's 100, 200. These collectives dissipate as people get older. Mm-hmm. People in their 50s and 40s, they got, yeah, well, I got two people who I hang with. I got five or six people I call, I try to avoid, you know? The individualization of movements have affected. That's why right. it's always cool for people, if you're lost, join a movement, join an organization. I work close with LA CAN, you know, Los Angeles Community Action Network, with Pete. I'm not a California native. My wife is. My daughter's born in California. It's important for me to lock in to a movement that's taking place to see where my contribution could be in, and that's not being the top preacher all the time. It's all a problem that I have with people that all of a sudden get found and all of a sudden they got to head up a church just because they had the money to build the church. Then sit your ass down, man. Listen to somebody who, collectives are so important, but then once you have a collective, then immediately you're under surveillance. And that's what they had done to hip hop and rap music. I mean, if I got to be a master teacher in anything, it's not in economics, it's not in society. Rap, race, and reality is what I talk about, but really seriously, rap music and music history, I'm a musicologist down to the core of what it is as art. I'm a raptivist, I'm a art academic, you know what I'm saying? Right. I've studied art, I've gotten degrees in it, I've done it, I've been to 104 countries doing music, been with the you know, all Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and all that. I study the core of art because art, to me, and culture, is the blood of human beings. And it's the thing that ties us together for our human being and knocks aside the differences. Once you get into the government, which it specifies in separating human beings and categorizes them and classifies them and individualizes them, what they did to rap music and hip hop was so dangerous because once we knew we could come in as a collective, you already mm-hmm. seen the movie Straight Outta Compton, they knew the only way for them to get in the game, they had to come in as a collective. They necessarily didn't dig each other, but they had to come in as a collective. And when they came in as a collective, they couldn't be stopped. We had movements coming from the East. The respect came from, oh wow, they're a group, they're an organization, they're a cluster, they're a posse, they're a crew. Which was like the lure of it, but also it was the respect.
Right.
And once they individualized the music, why did they individualize the music? It's easier to negotiate, or when you talk about rap music, easy to negotiate or negotiate with one person
right.
as opposed to a bunch of them.
Right.
So this became a business convenience, especially the major record companies who wanted to profit off of the music but not deal with the social aspect of it. And one person, you could flip, like, oh man, go live in Beverly Hills, man, you ain't gonna be bothered with them. I mean, the one thing when you talk about, and I'll be brief on this 60 seconds, when you talk about what works in this society, but whatever it is, and let's say athletes and entertainment, one thing, what works for the business, what they never understand is how close that people of color are attached by the blood to their family.
For sure.
It's usually like one or two people in the quote-unquote success business world of these aspects who happen to make it, but there's a large percentage based on the statistics, right? Mm-hmm. The reason Black Lives Matter, because Black is always at the bottom in the Western
right.
world.
Right.
The New World Order will show you that, because the New World Order is putting an effect on one of our brothers right now, Yasin Bey,
mm-hmm.
who had his passport, this is the game they're pulling now, we'll strip your passport, pull the Jack Johnson on you, and you can't go nowhere, nigga. Mm-hmm. So the nigga treatment is just on statistics. Oh, what are the 50 richest countries in the world? And what are the 50 poorest? And if you want to start saying characteristics, you start saying, well, damn, a lot of these people at the bottom are dark. That's why it matters, because it's been thrust at the bottom. But what they've done individually to hip hop and rap music is so they can really seriously neutralize an individual. You can flip the individual, but we're connected to our family so much. So they make these statements all the time, like, oh, this basketball player, he made $50 million in 1997, and now he's broke today. Well, you know, he shouldn't have had so many kids. Well, you know, he brought his mother a house, he brought his two brothers a house, he bought, he got caught up, his agents and his lawyer, So that math is another thing, but they were closely connected. Now they could detach from their families, right, which is advised. You know what? Get away from your loser family. Your loser family, or what? They're only asking for a life or money. Or they should be successful too, because of slavery and the inability to collect ourselves in a time just as family. And then later on, when they say, all right, now you guys could collect, it was like, okay, everybody else is like on your mark and set, go, and they 50 yards on already in the race. That inability to be able to call up a cousin lawyer. Oh yeah, my cousins over there, they own like 300 acres, and we did have that. But then they were sold and tried to assimilate. That's a whole nother story. But in rap music and hip hop and music in general, I'm just saying music in general, you've seen the disappearance of groups.
Yeah.
Why? Because they tell you on the surface, it's like, oh, it's too expensive to have 8 or 9 people in a group. I've had a group for 28 years. 28 years, run around the world, 104 countries. 28 years, made the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and all. Yeah, it ain't, you know what, it's like a family, you know? Yeah, there's bad days. Yeah, people within the situation, they don't have conversations every day with each other. But that's the only thing that made us survive. And it survives around the world a lot stronger than the individual United States of America, where they have reduced black lives into individuals.
Right.
And the music is individualized, where they name one person and two people, and if these two people happen to come together, then it has to be accepted by the companies or the lawyers. It's like that thing, that breakdown. And that, you know what? And I contributed into helping people in their individual self. I mean, Ice Cube came to me repeatedly and says, you know, really, I can't survive in this damn group because it's a little bit lopsided on the money end. But you know what? I want to do my solo project. So I produced with my guys Ice Cube's solo project, America's Most Wanted. But I encouraged at the same time still be a part of NWA. But then blood built up, and as much as I tried to dissipate that, it was like no other way he could come back. Tupac putting him on his first tour. He was with Digital Underground. You know, also produced, we did the soundtrack and the score for an old school movie called Juice. And that was Pox coming out as an individual. I always encourage, like, you could do your individual thing, but at least be part of the group and still do your individual thing, but know that you shouldn't stray that far off of the thing that made you. But there wasn't that attitude from the business to actually make my conversation on what would work long term for somebody to say, you know what, I could do this right now, and I could become rich and famous, and that's the lure that swells the ego enough for you to do it well. But in hindsight, you look back over the last 25 years, and look back specifically over the last 10 to 15 years, and it has been a dissolution of collectives and movement. And I say to any young person out there, whether you're doing anything, you cannot do anything successfully for a long period of time by your damn self. I don't care what it is, especially not in music, especially not in entertainment. Yeah, you might see them individualized, but I'm telling you, the team is always important. And that doesn't mean that you run your team. Be a part of the damn team.
Right.
The other day I was with Magic Johnson. You don't think that Magic Johnson, when he comes to the table, yes, he's Magic Johnson, but he deferred to Kareem. He talks about his team at the Lakers as being his core. Pat Riley, his coach. It goes the same thing in whatever you want to do in life. You got to be able to pay attention to your collective, because that's what's going to spearhead your movement forward, because it's got hate and all that other stuff working against it every speck of the way, because hate or haterade wants its position too. It wants its dominant position. So it's not against you personally. It just wants its dominant position. Right. Those in the spiritual space might say, God and the devil can't be in the same space. Night and day cannot be at the same point. So you got, you know, it's something that you want to work for to forward what your thoughts, I would say dreams if you're a dreamer, but your thoughts and your movement while you're breathing and conscious and living wants to go forward. And older people usually are societal dead weight in the way only because of their indoctrination, because they're
Watch out now, I represent that statement.
Well, I think they're
I'm playing.
In this country right now, you got a guy like Trump that goes off,
yeah,
right,
basically saying to people of color, black folk, and people who have not his whole understanding of wealth or how his greed is, saying, he's basically saying, what y'all gonna do? Y'all can't do nothing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And in order to fight, sometimes you gotta understand, fighting, man, there's people out there that's ready to fight you back and ready to kill you and put you under, not literally only, but figuratively, and really seriously have an agenda at it. And you gotta make sure, if you as an individual, you stepping in a room pumped up, you look at a martial artist in the face. Bruce Lee was 5'7". Dude was like, you know, with his head down. You just can't, oh, yeah, this, look at this. You get chopped up. So you better know how to fight. You better know how to fight. Mm-hmm. And the best way to know how to fight is with a crew that knows how to fight, who learn to fight together, to really make it understandable that, yeah, there's going to be times where you have to chill and not you know, not get beat down, but you're going to have to, you know, kind of like say, you know what, I'm going to look the other way on this one. That's what a fight is. This is not just about the battle. It's about the war.
That album you talked about, we're going to do a little bit of the America's Most Wanted. Not that particular album, but it made me think of America's Most Wanted. You had a great line in there. A lot of, you know, your contribution made. I can't remember. Ebony can't see to the right side. The term they apply to us is a nigga, call it what you want because it's coming from the corner. Same applies with a PhD. Who's black, don't want to roll, sells a soul. Watch his head go rolling. Who the fuck are they fooling? That's yeah. Chuck D right there. Yeah. Can you let him expand a little on whatever you got? A little Chuck.
Have you forgotten that once we were brought here, we were robbed of our name.
Living base.
Robbed of our language. We lost our religion, our culture, our God. And many of us, by the way we act, we even lost our mind.
Here it is. Bam. And you say, God damn, this is a dope jam. But let's define the term called dope, and you're thinking me funky now, no. Here is the true tale, why the ones that deal, all the ones that fail, yeah. You can move if you wanna move, what it prove. It's here like the groove, the problem is this. We gotta fix it, check out the justice, and how they run it. Selling, smelling, sniffing, riffing, and brothers trying to get swift in. Selling their own, rob a home, while some shrivelable, like comatose walking around. Please don't confuse this with the sound. I'm talking about
bass.
What's the night?
Bass.
Come on.
Bass.
What's the night?
Bass. Bass. Bass.
What's the night?
Bass. Bass.
What's the night?
Yeah, I just said, you know, I'm the church. You got to be straight up when you're dealing in a society with your loved ones, really seriously. You don't just salute people just because they do shit. You just say, I'm going to salute you. I salute people who they are and basically what they want to do. But if I see something I see that not going to work and they ask me for my advice, I'm not giving them instant salutes. Like, I'm like, how do you really feel about that? To the core. You got to test people on their belief down to the core. And they end up telling you that I'm just trying to figure it out. Well, we all trying to just figure it out. But, quick thing. I've been your age, you ain't been mine. So if you ask me for your advice, this is what I at least think. I'm not going to salute you automatically. Ain't no automatic salute. But I will commend you on what I see that will work if you're going to ask me for your advice. Two, if you're not going to ask me for your advice, but you're going to try to kind of be in my space trying to do what you want to do, I will give you some reference points and some other people you should pay attention to. I for years, never was like, oh, gangster rap, you shouldn't do that. I've encouraged cats are like, okay, if you want to do that, then maybe you'll get the powers that be to set you up to do a prison tour like Johnny Cash. But that ain't gonna happen in the United States of America. It happened for Johnny Cash. It ain't having no black person going to prisons doing rap tours. We the first that went in the prison system back in Rikers. And the minute we did that in 1988 and went to Rikers, which is in New York City, and turned it out.
Real rock from the rock.
Yeah, real rock. What they did is they put an APB out to everybody, every state, and said, this type of tour will not happen. And we didn't rile cats up. How you gonna rile somebody up in jail? Like, what are we gonna do? What, prison riot, there's a riot going on? That's a hypothetical, autistic BS from Elvis's day. I'm telling you that we was going in there with a sense of the same attitude that Johnny Cash had. Go in there to see if you can give some light. There's a prison industrial system back in that day, and it's designed from the 80s and 70s on up. Was it in the favor to have people who were incarcerated have a right state of mind? And the answer is no. How did we go from 100,000 black men in prison in 1970 to the numbers we have today? Some kind of glitch inside the program. Mm. And the glitch is also like this. And so the more we explain, we de-glamorize this whole quest for, I'm doing good, I'm successful, I'm making this, we getting that. Because of that, as an individual, we could begin to have an arm in the battle, because even when you're a step up, they're three steps ahead. When you go three steps ahead, they could be five steps ahead. The cheapest price in this world right now is to pay attention. It don't cost you a damn dime. Mm. But space and time is currency, and attention is currency. So this and this time, and it's shifted from the last 15 years. When I did those Public Enemy records, it's 1988, man. It's like old generations disappear, they die. New gens come in. People that you look, oh man, they're just a shorty. You know, that shorty is 33 years old. They are in the middle of the mix. The people that did racist things in the 50s and 60s, 90% of them are dead. If they're around at 90 and 85 years old, the system to them and the rhetoric and the words that they believe in, those are the things that matter. And they've been quick to tell you in our lives, it's mind over matter. Back in the day, they would say that about black folk. It's like, mind over matter. Really seriously? I don't mind beating your ass, and you don't matter. So with that, we say Black Lives Matter. To throw off people that want to throw in the same, it's like the same conversation they used to say back in the day. Oh, pro-black. Mm-hmm. And the minute somebody, oh, you're anti-white, and you go through a whole damn week educating them, like, you're right, you know? I'm like, I can get time for that. Yeah. So Black Lives Matter. Oh, you got a problem with that? Oh, I'm white. Okay, we got to explain white supremacy to you. Listen, no lives matter if we don't matter. How about that?
Right.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. When people, well, I got to have a way with words, because I ain't got time with people to waste with words. Mm. I mean, my youngest is 4 years old. I got to figure out words with her in her world. Before I talk to somebody 35 years old, I gotta reprogram them real quick in the conversation, keep it moving. Oh yeah, you gotta have people challenge themselves and their beliefs, because having them challenge your beliefs is a waste of damn time. Just have them like, okay, what do you believe? True to the core. You say you love it, how much about what you say you love do you know? And you find out they know only half of what they say they love. Well, get more into what you say you love, and then I'll roll with you. Damn, is it that easy? I wanted an argument out of you. Nah, sorry, son. I didn't mean to cut you off, but you know.
Oh, no. This is great. I'm going to let Lene get in the mix here. You know, we got to have the DJ weigh in a little bit here, and then we'll get back to wrapping up.
And I was going to try to be quiet, but it's a difficult thing, because I want to talk a little bit about the fact that DJs are suffering from a particular kind of depression right now, and part of that is that we are existing in a world with what I'm calling pedestrian listeners, because radio has dumbed us down to such a ridiculous degree that when I stand in front of an audience and play music that I know is sacred and historic, there's no response. And in fact, I am treated like a jukebox. Can you play the new such and such that I've heard 107 times in the last week? No, sir. right? And so, just for example, and not to shame anyone, how many of you listen to hip hop? Raise your hands. How many of you have spent any time with a Public Enemy album? That's awesome and that's surprising, because there's a major disconnect, right? Especially in a world where we're living in a 99 cent a song culture, right? iTunes has shifted our relationships with albums. So as a student of Afrika Bambaataa, of Chuck D, of BDP, of MC Lyte, of De La Soul, of Tribe Called Quest, you know, I just want to say that please go home and actually do some homework on the history of our music, because it was through hip hop that I developed a critical consciousness, that I started reading, but also that I started learning about the civil rights movement. I started learning about the fuckery of the Reagans and the Bushes. I started thinking critically for myself because of what was happening for me in a bedroom. And to bring it back full circle, I'm gonna have to say, I really want us to have some nuanced conversations about the word nigga. And I refuse to say the N-word, because it's a word that is so emotionally charged, and I want each person to think about why it makes them feel uncomfortable. And part of that is because it's an ugly word with an ugly, violent, brutal history, but also a beautiful word with a beautiful history, right? So I have a complex relationship with it. As a DJ, I love a well-placed nigga in a song. I love when someone says it well over the beat. I'm like, Kendrick Lamar did that with the song All Right. But when I go on a train in Brooklyn and hear young people saying it in front of elders, I struggle and want to snatch them up, right? So I have that complex relationship. When Richard Pryor said, I am no longer gonna use that word, people were upset, people were overjoyed, right? Both at once. So the question is, do Black people possess the magic to reclaim that word and to shift the energy? Or is it a word that keeps us, you know, in this zombified state? What is it? Is it both and, right? So just thinking about the complexity of the word and thinking about why it makes you, you know, uncomfortable, thinking about the fact that sometimes that conversation is about class division, intergenerational differences, right? And so just, those are just some things. So please, support your local DJs by engaging a full album that was made in 1987. Just engage it, or 1992. Right? And finally and lastly, the fact that Chuck D is here is so huge. It's so huge, certainly for me. But I want to personally thank you for hooking Ice Cube up with the Bomb Squad. Because that was a win for LA. And my sister who is here introduced me to hip hop. And I was like, hold on, why has Ice Cube's music changed? Like, it is so full of life. Not only did he hook up with the Nation of Islam and Khalid Muhammad, he hooked up with Chuck D, Public Enemy, and the Bomb Squad. Chuck D and Ice Cube had a song together called Endangered Species that just changed the game of what they call gangster rap versus conscious rap. Right. That was a direct sign of resistance against the music industry, too. So thank you for that.
I'm going to Eric to speak, and I'm going to take another question or two from the audience.
Can I say something for a second?
Eric, speak for a moment. And
okay.
Then
okay. Yeah, I'll be quick about it, I promise. I really didn't have much to say. I just wanted to say I shared a mic with Chuck D. no, it's you know, it's something that I heard both from Chuck, but also just now about DJ culture and how it's suffering from a certain kind of ignorance amongst its audience. And I think that relates to speech, surveillance, and censorship in a way that we don't always think about. And that's sampling laws. Yeah. I mean, if you think about it, what made It Takes a Nation of Millions, you mentioned De La Soul. I mean, Bomb Squad, De La Soul, these were master samplers. Those albums cannot be made today. And one of the reasons for that is, over time, the ability for rappers to sample has been eroded to the point where it's so expensive that Kanye, Jay-Z, and a few others can do it. And often, they're just dropping it in, so you know how expensive that sample was. But that was that was a very important way of calling and responding, right? This is at the center of sort of African American, but also African musicking, right? This call and response. Sampling allowed for that. Sampling was how rappers actually took records from people who'd become obscure, that previous generation, and started a conversation with them in their music. And then all of a sudden, young kids who are coming up and are trying to become rappers, they now are familiar with a whole new generation, I mean, a whole different generation of musicians. And they stop thinking about this as myself, and they start seeing themselves within a much broader community. And I think that that relates both to politics, right? And I've had a long conversation with Hank Shockley of the Bomb Squad. He's one of the masters. And you know, we talked about how it's probably not a coincidence that for a while anyway in mainstream rap, you saw political consciousness drop just as you saw sampling drop. And that's because sampling provided that important link, and it also provided that important literacy that I think people forget now. Rappers are oftentimes nerds, right? They know that they're the smartest people in a room. Through consolidation, through corporate interest, radio station consolidation, I mean, we can go on and on about that. Rap has, at least mainstream rap, has been distilled down to something that isn't that anymore. I do see new avenues right now, new business models, thanks in large part to social media, which also allows something like the Black Lives Matter movement to have such efficacy. But with a warning, with a caveat, that those same technologies that are making these models possible, where you don't even have to sell your music to make a living anymore, you can do it off touring, merchandise, and things like that, but those are the same media that now police are increasingly monitoring to the point where gang units, I've seen this, right, will spend 50% of their time just combing through that, instead of going out collecting actual evidence, meeting members of the community. They introduce that as evidence and you go away. And so we have to think about ways to leverage social media, but also be aware that it has its own pitfalls. It's the message that Chuck said earlier, right? Old tricks just disguised in new ways. And social media, we have to be especially careful there.
Can I say something for a second? $1 million bomb. Goddamn, motherfuckers, that slump nigga shit was lower than mine. You mean to tell me for some pictures you give me 100 years? Hang me in the media, dog me in from my peers when the truth is. I've been living out here for years, man. This shit been going on before niggas was even here. Charge me with some other niggas' crime. Where they do that? All for some motherfucking rhymes, nigga, you black. True facts of what my life don't matter. Police could bust their guns and make my window shatter. I can't breathe, my hands up. Bart cop, my hands cuffed. He still shot like, bah, nobody has to answer. Would have dressed this after Trayvon Martin and Emmett Till. Man, these motherfuckers can't be for real. Sign a deal for some shit that I ain't do. Meanwhile, George Zimmerman out here free as an angel. Lord, please send me an angel. What's they fucking angle? I don't understand how this man could fucking strangle a black man and go to sleep like it never happened. But want to give me life because I was out here rapping. Goddamn, we need Huey back. Goddamn, we need Huey back. Goddamn, we need Huey back. A gangbanger's the new black, how true is that? It's a proven fact that they hate us. Now instead of the rope, they send a jury to come hang us. Goddamn, we need Huey back. And my name is Brandon Tiny Dude Duncan.
Yeah.
I was... I was affected by the same situation. I was incarcerated for 7 months over my rap lyrics, you know what I'm saying? So this whole situation is deep to me, is near to me, you know what I'm saying? And I just thank God, you know what I'm saying, that this type of stuff is going on right now, because it's rappers going to jail every day over the stuff we say when it's our artistic expression. We should be able to express ourselves just like Johnny Cash can, just like anybody else can, just like dude from Queen can, that can express themselves and say and talk about killing people and doing everything else, but it's just a big record for them. But for us, it's life in prison. So, you know, I'm just here. Thank everybody for being here. Thank you, Chuck D, and thank everybody up there for, you know what I'm saying, fighting for our rights, because, you know, we need that. Thank you, God.
Can I say another thing? First of all, I commend and salute you. The community at hand, and world situation, but definitely a country problem in this nation. The community has not supported the arts. They support sports programs left and right, put people in stadiums, get people to come to USC, give them scholarships, it's on TV. When it comes down to the arts, and the arts is music and culture, from babies we humming and singing and rhyming and want to say good things about sunshine and avocados and all that. It has not been woven into the curriculum of this country, if ever, properly. Speaking of this, we want to keep it black. If you just teach black music and music from grades kindergarten to 12, You get history by default.
Yep.
You get perspective, you get feelings, you get so much education just teaching music. You get it's like tree timelines, rings in a tree. Then at the same time, when there's poetry, arts, does it get rewarded? Does it get subsidized? Does it get funded in the community? I was very clear back in the day, still use this as a statement. If the community does not support the arts, how can you expect the arts to support or protect the community? What's the reward when somebody comes up and spits something that could actually add life and nutrition and vibration to so many just out of the timbre of their voice and feeling? Should it only be contained inside a church during a hymn? We haven't gotten around, I'd say we as a collective in any community haven't gotten around to at least bring the artistic reward to someone. And not to go out there and look on television or what these companies got, somebody got to make a killing and they got these Lambos flying and whatnot. No, I'm saying like, can this person live in their community, make a living as an artist and supply that nutrition to his community and be able to say, well, you know, I'm making my living as an artist in my community. That has not even been the case. So it's dissipated to the point where around the 80s, it took companies to sign people to say, all right, you know, we'll support that living. And then people only look to companies and as a consumer product to support the arts, where the community has never gotten behind it or had the funds to get behind it. But I'll tell you one damn thing for sure. Every high school team got a basketball team. Every high school got a basketball team, got a football team, putting them on TV. ESPN got 20 channels. And everything's about sports and sports and sports. Pro, amateur is supported by the community. The arts, we're gonna leave the arts up to see if somebody from Def Jam can sign somebody. And so we'll see them on TV, or maybe they make a movie. And all these areas that are beneficial off of the backbone of the arts and its profits, where are they in the curriculum of encouraging young people that they can do the arts and feel normal and still live in their community and by doing the arts and maybe, hopefully, make a living supplying the arts? Why isn't this woven into the school curriculum? And I've been screaming about that the last 30 years because half of the curriculum is outdated. It takes a lot of money to flip it. But if you got kids on a phone, inside, outside, also already got their phone in their heads, and they already spitting this and that, and they're being entrenched by entertainment, and some bigwig living in Beverly Hills is actually profiting off of this energy worldwide, where's the accountability for this cat to actually say, let's plug it into the curriculum? I understand that, you know, okay, Jimmy Iovine and Dre, they make the deal with Apple, and Apple has this money, and the money goes into USC, and I understand that as something that happened. But that ain't the only thing that's been out there that has profited off of the energy of artistry and culture. And the people of color, art and culture has been lifeblood because we weren't able to express ourselves, whether we felt good or bad about anything. This is why the two-year-old seems to all of a sudden flow and habit come out of them. It's in the acquired DNA of being able to not say anything, and now it's just flowing. What do you do with this energy? This energy has to be taught, because if it's not taught, it's not encouraged. People in the arts who have the ability, who have worked at it, to enlighten so many people, if they're not supported, then you're leaving it up for big business to use it as trickery. And trickery is the thing where, okay, by the way, I don't live there, and we ain't connected like that. And yeah, you're a human, I'm a human, but you know, we're not family. So therefore, whatever goes and whatever seems to work will work, and we'll get behind it. And no one has the sophistication to break down the level of what's been coming at them 30 years. People just eat food. A lot of people just eat food. They ain't trying to figure out how you make it, how long you warm it up, what spices in it. It's like, does it taste good or tastes bad? And that's where we've reduced the arts and culture down to, is it good or is it bad for me? Is it sugary? Is it sweet? I just know when I eat it. I ain't worried about what's happening in the kitchen. But in sports, everybody's got it figured out. Oh, I got my training going. Jordan got this 4.5. He ran a sprint. They've educated you on that business. So. Yeah.
I talk so much that it's been so good, and you have spent so many years. I feel like if all of us just sat here and listened to you for the entire time, it would be that valuable. But what I will say is I have spent 30 years implementing curriculum. The two areas, excuse my language, but we are so fucked up. We don't teach emotional or financial literacy, and so I've dedicated my life to utilizing arts for those two reasons. We've got to understand the geography of our hearts and our pockets. And the other thing, in the process of developing curriculum, we started out with the word nigga, which rarely comes out of my mouth because I do feel like for me, I don't need to use the word, but I think it's important. And I think we have to stop separating one another, and that anybody in the fight to end oppression has to embrace our young people and listen. And even if it's a scream to just be heard, that we have to move out of the way and let young people vent and speak, and then we can take them somewhere. And that's why I think your book, I mean, it was hard for us to get in San Quentin, because the warden is concerned about the title of Professor Armour's book, and what is he thought he might be a little crazy. Now, he's so thrilled that we came in and we made such a shift in our work inside that for all of us, myself included, that have judgments and strong opinions, sometimes we need to move out of the way and embrace those that have different ideas and different opinions, and to study. And so I think everyone should read your book. It was not a book that a lot of people even wanted to read because of the title. And I think that we have to be willing to examine language and be wrong. And so with that, you know, our whole topic was what shouldn't be said. And I just wanted to bring it full circle and not be afraid, because we don't understand. And I don't want to see more division. I want to see us come together. And so thank you for having us here. And if anyone wants to know, my organization is now Aim for the Heart, because if you're going to aim, you might want to aim where it matters. So, you know, and I work with Jody. I'm blessed to teach with him. Thank you, Chuck, for coming all this way. You came a long way. So we appreciate you.
I didn't want to ask. Can y'all hear me? I didn't want to ask a question. I just wanted to touch on something that y'all all keep bringing up. And real quick, what he said about the sports, you know, they really grabbing your natural tribal energy. So you don't go protest with Black Lives Matter or somewhere, get out there. You go during the Laker parade and burn some shit, you know. You really, they think about that for a second. They really taking what you were born with, your natural energy, and having you get into some nonsense and believe in some bull that doesn't really matter, so you forget about what really matters. But I think the important thing is, I'm 40 years old. I grew up listening to Chuck, you know, everybody, and like he talked about, they were giving us a message, and we had that message, and we shared it with our friends because, dang, check these lyrics out, they dope, and then our friend got the message too. But you talk about the old heads not being, or being afraid of the youth, and nobody taught us. Well, at least you guys did, but nobody, I think a lot of times, nobody taught us that now we're the old heads now, and we gotta make sure that we educate the youth. And the problem, like the sister said, about the music being dumbed down, they're not getting the message from the music anymore or anything, and a lot of people are just dumb and ignorant. And those of us that are intelligent, we don't realize it, or we don't realize the magnitude of that ignorance. And what he said, and what y'all keep talking about, I think is important. Like, we as Rasta say, each one teach one, because each one is one. And I think it's important that we continue to educate one another. The reason I say so is just this week, my mother came to me and was asking me about the Stacey Dash thing. My mother is a white woman with 3, maybe 4 masters, like psychology, education. She's a school psychologist. When I got to explaining to her that every day is White History Month, that everything you do is white, everything they teach you in school is white, you occasionally learn about a black person, but you learn about white folks every day. When I explained to her that, you know, not only that, but there has to be a black entertainment television, Mom, because all programming is white entertainment television. She didn't have nothing to say. And then I wanted to use her Amazon account to order a book, Mumia book, We Want Freedom, the Panther Party, growing up in the Black Panther Party. When I realized that my white mother, with master's degrees, didn't know who Mumia Abu-Jamal was at 60-something years old, that blew my mind. And that was just this week. So I've realized it's my job to teach other white people that don't really know what's going on, because I assume, because I'm intelligent, that people know and people are as smart as me, but that's not the deal. And whether it's through hip-hop, whether it's educating other white people, whether it's educating one another, we really need to remember that. I live in Long Beach, where I work with the inner city youth, and the kids tell me I'm a BG. That doesn't mean I'm a baby gangster. That means I'm a bastard gangster. That means I have no OGs. F what them dudes say. You know what I mean? I'm not listening to them. They don't show no respect. They run around. They ride on churches and people's houses. They rob old ladies. Stuff that we didn't do. Even though we was gangbanging and doing stuff, we had a certain code of ethics that we live by. We didn't ride on a school. We didn't ride on a church. You know, these are bastard gangsters. They don't got no OGs. They don't listen. And it's up to us collectively, not just these people on stage, but it's a collective responsibility when we have this intelligence to go share this intelligence with other people, because it's seriously dumbed down. So that's all.
All right, this is absolutely our last one, man.
I got a mic right here.
Very good.
Thank you, brother. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Azhar Usman. I'm a stand-up comedian, and I'm from Chicago.
You were great earlier.
I was in the show earlier, in the program earlier.
He brought down the house. I'm sorry some of y'all didn't see him.
It was great.
Thank you. Chuck D, you're like an idol to me, man. So this is really weird to be in the same room with you. And Brother Ali is like one of my closest friends on earth. So I talk about you all the time behind your back. The question I have is with respect to the tension in the heart of an artist with respect to mingling of economics in art. And it's my, you know, belief that, you know, that paradox and that tension is always present. I mean, on the one hand, it's like, you know, burn Hollywood, burn. But on the other hand, the only reason we all know who you are is because Public Enemy was a commercially successful band. And so there is this paradox at play. And I'm not gonna lie, man. Part of my heart died when Ice-T, who wrote Cop Killer, was a cop on Law and Order. I was like, what happened? And then I saw, you know, Ice Cube, who wrote Fuck the Police, is a cop on 21 Jump Street. Like, what is happening? Why are they like killing all our leaders by making them cops? And so the tension I feel as an artist, and I would love for you to comment on this, and Layla, I would love if you would, you know, offer some insight here as well, is how to negotiate dancing with the devil. Because Burn Hollywood, Burn, on the one hand, I grew up like listening to that song in my bedroom as a teenager and being like, yo, fuck Hollywood. But now I'm here in the belly of the beast and trying to negotiate that tension and walk through that minefield sometimes can seem impossible. Because on the one hand, it's like you don't want to sell out. On the other hand, you don't want to, you know, compromise your artistic integrity in any way. You also don't want to sit on the sidelines and just die. It can seem impossible, and I would love any insight and wisdom from the two of you about how to negotiate and navigate that minefield.
Yes, yes, that's a nice one to cap it off. Y'all take it away, cap it off with that, and then I'm going to go out. But what a great, you know, wind-up question.
Well, number one, you grown. So negotiating with life as an adult is different than as a child. Are you going to make, you know, you got your do's, your don'ts, your wills, your won't, especially if you got, like, kids. So you got to negotiate how you fit into the world and into the space. I tell people, sometimes don't think that the accountability and responsibility of the burden of the earth is going to be on your shoulders. Handle your cipher, your surrounding space, and if you can't change your head, adapt your head. If you can't change your crib where you live, how are you going to take on your block, your community, the state, the country, the world? So build with like minds and like-minded situations to help, it's about building your core. And can you actually elevate past, especially if your core is positive and it's about the positive energies around you and you actually are able to propel your family and not kind of like at your benefit and somebody else's expense, which is kind of whack, that's greed. So I know you as a comedian and Muslim, you have to negotiate that space on what's cool and what's not cool. And like, just anything don't go. Same thing as an adult. Once you cross a threshold, when you kind of really know you're no longer a kid, everything is about negotiation because you ain't going to be here forever. The only thing that's going to be left is your deeds, your word maybe. So it's about a negotiation because you don't have the control of, nobody has the mastery of time. You can only best manage your time. Long story short, I think what we can do as human beings on this planet Earth is to negotiate the fight to be able to be of the Earth and less of a nation or a country. I tell people, say, well, you're a citizen, you're a state citizen, you're from New York. I'm a citizen of the planet Earth, damn sure by now. So why would I have a government have the final say-so of who I am and what I should do? It would make you look at Hollywood like this is really a small thing. If you got a purpose and a mission and a job, you make sure it negotiates with you as much as you negotiate with it. You make sure that you ain't like kissing up to no nothing. It's got to be able to meet you halfway. Or you sign a record deal. Did they sign your papers too? Nah, they ain't trying to do that. Well, you pretty much have, employment then. Everything's about negotiation. And I think as adults, the best way to negotiate to get where you want to go is being part of a collective and a movement to have like minds at least sometimes tell you, yeah, you tripping. Or, yo, that sounds like a good move. I got your back. I'll support that. Police. I mean, when you open your minds to the rest of the world, seriously, whether you go there or not, which I think it should be a mission for people, they got dreams. Dream not to be alien and visit planet Earth. You know what I'm saying? But governments don't want, especially now, they don't want human beings to be free. Right now, you got fear of a black or a brown person visiting the planet Earth, visiting the planet. Yasin Bey, the New World Order is already saying, really, nigga, you better off dead. And that's when the N-word comes in context.
Right.
Nigga, no, you can't stay in South Africa. Oh, yeah, but you can't come back here. Matter of fact, if you come back here, then you can't go nowhere else. They already have positioned chains on the brain to make sure people within the 2,000 by 3,000, 48 state box of the USA will make you stay put like a slave, don't think nowhere else, detach yourself from the diaspora, and see if you can freestyle and come up with your own way of survival here. I've said this many times, and I'm very clear about this, especially going around the damn planet Earth so many times I have over the last 30 years. If people of color, and lack of a better word, because human beings are human beings, white supremacy is who came up with the race rules. But if people of color detach ourselves from the diaspora outside the US of A, we will forever be a slave.
That's right.
Forever be a slave.
That's
right. I don't care about your individual success. I don't care if you're able to feed your nuclear family or whatever. You will forever be a slave if you detach the rest of the places where human beings live. You won't be able to align yourself with the sentiments and feelings of struggle. You got people here with the nerve to have comments about brown people when they build pyramids on this side of the planet and also have the Americas talking about, oh, it can't come into California or New Mexico. There's a wall right here between Mexico and the United States that has been more blasphemous than the wall they all raised their hands and saluted when the world wall over in Berlin came down. Mm-hmm. We toured over there and had to figure out, you know, all right, you got to go to Berlin. So here we are in West Germany. You get waken up by the East. They wake you up in dogs in the middle of the night. There's one road to go to Berlin, which is split in half. And when the Berlin Wall came down, myself and Brother Malik over there seen it come down while we're doing a concert. Why? Because years that we would go to Berlin, there's people on the East side that can't come to the concert. So we communicating to people for the first time, able to come to the concert because the walls come down. Musicians, for years, and also to a lesser degree athletes, but musicians are the passports. Once they start limiting musicians from going to the rest of the world to follow our muse and our words, that's the new world order. And I'm saying it's always a negotiation to align yourself up with the planet. And that's the fight that people have as far as, you know, you want to call yourself American? Fine, that's a little arrogant because all this is the Americas.
Right.
All right? You want to call yourself a USAer? I could dig that. That means you're clear about where you are. Can you leave it on your own terms? You're a citizen of it? You tell me you can, and I'll tell you ways that most of you can't. So these are the struggles, I think, in the negotiations that when you figure it out, playing a cop on a movie or a TV show, what does that mean? I mean, I went to Ghana and cop and police in Ghana, everybody black there. He fired two shots in the air and this line that was unruly and brought it around the people's heads and y'all get in line, everybody got in line. So police brutality, is it a black thing? Is it, you don't know, it's a systematic core that's rotting because of a lot of different reasons. Does that mean F the police? No, it's really saying F the government.
Right.
Because the police are the government watchdogs. Mm. You have to change the and fight the law. People are, oh, it's just the law. They have to abide by the law. The cops, they're more nervous than ever. What a 22-year-old police officer in Ferguson know? But B, he mad that he got to patrol the black area and then got to say, well, all these people act like heathens. Well, how many black people you know? I don't really care for knowing black people. I just met one 2 years ago, but I've known them for 5 years on Facebook. So people think that they know people of color just because you're online with a bunch of them or you've seen these movies. And I don't mean to get long-winded, but I'm saying the science and the racism now is based on people that think they know about us based on what they've been exposed to. So it's been a Pandora's box of, yeah, it's art, it's culture. Y'all see many movies. Rap music has gotten to the lyrics. We've grown up. Yes, the culture has united human beings and the similarities, but the system has separated and identified human beings and have taken advantage of this. So therefore, you can't get lazy with it. Oh yeah, I know black folks because I've had a black friend 800 miles away in the hood in East St. Louis, and we communicate all day. Have you ever met him personally? Nah. Mm-hmm. I don't know his family or none of that, but you know, I've seen pictures. Cool, yeah. That's an intro. What's the burden of the friendship? Oh, no, you spooking me out with too much of that, whatever. But I'm saying that the negotiation happens nonstop. So it ain't the thing of Ice-T is in a movie or a TV show and they're playing. But it's not the concept of police. You need police, but to protect the community and the community law as opposed to something that's thrust into the community as law. The problem I had with police when I was growing up in Nassau County in Long Island is that most of the police never ever came from the same community. So they said, no, police always got to come from the outside because of the reasons somebody might feel too friendly with the people and they take advantage of it. I'm like, who told you that? Well, that's just the rules. So police and the relationship has always been kind of tenuous, but it also depends on where you go and what discussion you have with who. My mother and father come from Harlem. They tell me when police was in Harlem in 1946, in 1951, in 1957, they were positioned in Harlem to work by foot. So they had to know people, and they had to negotiate all the time with the community at times. Cats were broke, they were poor, they were mad too. They had to negotiate. They had problems, they had situations. Today, and also because of the system, the social area of places, police sit in tanks. They sit in tanks, they chill out, they watch with equipment, tools, focus in on people. It's a different game, it's war, you know what? And if you go up against that army, you're gonna get dealt with some bodies, the biggest gang in the country right about now. And they're being tested with words right now. They're being tested with movements right now. And that movement ain't towards police. It's shallow to say it's towards the police. No, it's the damn law. And the law done been in effect in this country in so many lopsided ways that you need people to not only protect the law, you need people to take the law apart and rebuild it. But looking at monstrosities like, what, the State of the Union? Well, last week with a room full of fakers?
Yeah.
How you going to think you're going to change the law? You know, not a goddamn thing that's going on in that room. They all talk about new laws in there. Oh, by the way, writing, passing new invisible laws like in the last 2 months. You know, shipping so many people out of the United States over the last 2 months. Like, oh yeah, you can't belong here on the planet Earth. We want to ship your ass out. You don't deserve to stay here. How many people got that damn belief? Like, you don't deserve to make a claim over the damn planet. Forget my utopian hippie speech. But that's
really
that's
fast. I'm going to add just something because I heard her say we had to get out of here. But what I was going to say in answer to what you said, my grandmother used to always say the saying about keep your enemies close is bullshit. Run across the street and you become what you want to save. And that was one of the lessons that Pac and I learned that was so difficult, is that you can't surround yourself with people and think that you're not affected by them. And so you can't dance with the devil. And you have to realize that you don't have to be of what you're around. And I wanted to make a difference in the streets, and I brought the streets into my home, and I paid dearly for it. Pac wanted to represent the community and make a difference. And he morphed into what he wanted to save and got caught up in it. And so, as you're navigating that territory, back to what you were saying about that community, even if it's small, stay connected to your community and don't let what you don't want to become into your home.
Yeah, that's real.
Layla Steinberg, Mr. Chuck D, Eric Nielsen, you know Melina Abdullah, Doc Melly Mel, going back to Grandmaster Flash and Furious 5, The Message, we might have that somewhere on there. And Lene, Denise, thank you very much. This is really a kind of an unprecedented panel. You know, if you think about it, you don't kind of see this mix of folks. And thanks all thanks to all the great work that was done by the What We Cannot Say, Words We Cannot Say folk, you know, which is... without Nomi, who's really been doing the heavy lifting, oh my God, we wouldn't be here today. So thank you, Nomi, and everyone else.
Yeah. Thank you,
thanks for coming, and that's it. Thanks, folks.